There are numerous simple tips that parents can use to help students maximize their chances for success. Top in the list is simply attending every class while being rested and alert. Now, clearly, a lot can be done at home before arriving at school to make sure this happens. For example, simple actions like making sure the student gets to school on time after a good night's sleep will have a positive impact. Now, even though precisely the right things are being done at home, these exact same issues can be a problem. And the reason for this is what's inside the school, specifically the air. Now, indoor air is a complex mixture of gases and suspended particles. And with every breath, a student is sampling this mixture. And every breath matters. There are many forms of indoor air pollution that come from a range of different sources. Particulates, such as dust or mold, can irritate the airways, causing a range of respiratory issues from a cough or sore throat through to triggering asthma attacks. Volatile organic compounds, or VOCs, from things such as cleaning products or building materials can cause respiratory issues similar to those caused by particulates. Along with that, studies have also found that they can affect concentration. Carbon dioxide, or CO2, while commonly associated with climate change, is another form of indoor air pollution. CO2 has been shown to affect how well students perform scholastically, specifically when the concentration of CO2 exceeds 1500 ppm. Measurable reductions in decision-making speed and problem-solving have been reported. As the CO2 concentration gets higher, over 2000 ppm, students may even become drowsy, further negatively affecting their performance in school. Now, in a classroom, the main source of indoor CO2 is exhalation. Thus, along with the CO2, aerosols also exhaled. So if the CO2 concentration in the air is high, the amount of exhaled aerosol in the room can also be high. Microbes like influenza, measles, SARS-CoV-2, and other viruses associated with a common cold may be exhaled within the aerosol. And this can happen even if a person is not showing any symptoms. Now, if the space is poorly ventilated, then the amount of airborne bacteria and viruses will accumulate. It's been recently reported that CO2 itself will help some airborne viruses to remain infectious in the air longer, allowing them to accumulate even further. The combination of all these factors will increase the likelihood of infection, resulting in illness and an increase in sick days. Collectively, this means that indoor air quality affects students' performance in a number of different ways. Fortunately, indoor air is something that we can control. This raises two questions. How, and how do we know the actions we've taken to clean the air have actually worked? Let's deal with this one at a time. So how can we improve indoor air? Well, for that, we have a number of tools in our toolkit that cover a broad range of costs and efficiencies. An easy and effective method is through natural ventilation. By simply opening a window, the particulates, aerosol, and CO2 that cause problems can get physically removed. Now, sometimes opening a window isn't even an option. For example, many schools have their windows either painted or screwed shut, while others have windows that simply don't open much. This will significantly limit the ability to use natural ventilation. More modern buildings may have heating, ventilation, and air conditioning, or HVAC systems. HVAC systems are useful as they will automatically ventilate the air. Now, if natural or mechanical ventilation are simply not options, other tools may need to be used. For example, filtration. There are many filtration devices available on the market, where there's a broad range in their effectiveness. Now, if cost is an issue, it's also possible to build your own air filtration unit with some filters and a fan. I'll provide a link in the description for a video to walk you through exactly how to do that. All right then, so we have all these simple things we can do to lower the amount of indoor air pollution. Let's say one enacts a change. How do we know if what they've done has actually helped? Now, during the pandemic, a lot of tools have become available that are incredibly useful for one to be able to assess their indoor air quality. Specifically, many classrooms were provided with CO2 monitors. While not perfect, CO2 monitors are powerful tools to be able to assess indoor air quality. First off, they can measure how much CO2 is in the room. Now, as mentioned, when the CO2 levels are high, students may begin to lose focus. So letting in some outdoor air when the CO2 level is up can help. CO2 monitors can also be used to measure ventilation. Now, ventilation is measured by the terms air exchanges per hour, or ACH for short, where the term simply means the average number of times the air in a room is replaced per hour. An ACH of 5 or above is deemed to be pretty good, but anything higher will be better. And you can use a CO2 monitor to easily measure the ACH of a room. This is done through simply measuring how fast the CO2 in an empty room lowers over time. I've explained this in a previous video. Here's a link for that. Now, with this simple technique, one can readily see how minor changes, such as opening a window, will have on the ACH. In short, with a simple CO2 monitor and a little time, you can optimize your room's air quality. All right, so when it comes to improving indoor air quality, there are some short-term solutions that anyone can enact. So things like ventilation, using portable filters, using different cleaning products to limit the VOCs, keeping the humidity between 30 and 50% to stop mold growth, assess the indoor air quality with a CO2 monitor. You can also limit the amount of pollution being generated, so doing things like simply putting out candles or not using candles. All of these can be done right now. Now, over a longer period of time, bigger changes can be made. So things like improving air quality standards. Schools could get individual ventilation audits. Some could be retrofitted with bespoke solutions. Now, finally, or even there's long-term solutions that we can go for. So things like fitting improved air filtration systems, or even building new schools to upgrade ventilation standards. Clearly, there are a range of solutions that cover a range of costs. Numerous case studies have shown that by improving indoor air quality, this will directly improve how well students will perform in school. The fact of the matter is this: indoor air quality is a choice, and it's one that we make every single day. Moreover, it's one that we have a lot of control over, and we can always do better. If you think this is important, and would like some additional information, check out Clean Air for Kids UK, link in the description.